Hello and welcome to the second day of FOF. We are so excited to have you in here with us this morning. This first song we're going to sing, I'm going to invite you to stand. It's called Man of Your Word. And the words of the song say, God, you have never failed and you won't start with me. So join us as we sing this.
Possible when we believe, all chains are breakable. When we receive your way, you keep your promises.
You sing.
If you said it, we believe it. If you said it, if you said it, we believe it. Whoa, oh, oh.
You'll finish what you started. God, you have never failed. You won't start with me. You're present in every step. You're patient with every heartache. God, you have never failed. You won't start with me.
And we have this confidence that you'll finish what you started.
Welcome to the 2022 Olympics, where we are going to test who is the most elite student of Avondale.
We have only the best, most athletic, most conventionally attractive, most just all-rounders to go head-to-head in the most challenging activities we can think of.
Let's start with introducing our athletes.
May the best student win her. Round one, Bible flicking. 3, 2, 1, flick!
Pre-marital eye contact. Are our contestants ready? They are looking like it. Okay, 3, 2, 1, go! Now that we have the winners of Tali and Eddie, we are on to round 2 of pre-marital eye contact. Are our contestants ready?
Yes.
Now it's time for round 3.
Race.
3, 2, 1, go! Otherwise, it's...
And now we're here to announce our winner, Tali, to go dinner. Can you just say a few words for your victory? Yes, thank you so much. Tali Kama out. He messed up the Bible.
And I was momentarily blind.
This is amazing. This is amazing.
Wow, that was such a good video.
That was such a good video.
Whoa, where's Carly and Kay?
Wow, where is Carly and Kay? Hi, guys. So, we had a thought. How can you guys get a seat at the table if you don't properly know us? Hi, I'm exactly. Kate. Nice to meet you,
I'm
Ellie
Van. Nice to meet you.
Hi, I'm Kate. Hi.
Taylor, nice to meet you.
I'm Kate. Nice to meet you Kate, guys. So. Hi. Handshake. That was a solid handshake.
What's your
great
name?
Handshake. Hi,
nice
guys.
Nice to meet you.
I'm Kate.
You guys look so
nice
wonderful in your
you.
Sports costumes. I don't have a costume, but I have the flag of the best rugby sevens team on my back right now. Purr.
Cute.
Anyway, so good to see you guys. Thank you for watching the video. I hope you guys enjoyed that.
For your curiosity, that was baked beans, tomato juice, milk, and water. There were a few questions about that. Wow, guys.
So good to see you guys this morning. Hey, good morning.
Good morning.
Thanks for coming to the morning
Day
session.
Day 2. That's so exciting,
very exciting.
Guys.
Yes.
Great jerseys. I love it. You guys look really amazing today. Can you guys turn around to the people next to you and be like, hey, you look great today.
And turn to the other side and just be like, I like your jersey. And if you're not wearing one, I still like what you're wearing.
Fashion taste. Okay, so today we are wearing your favorite sports team. Apparently I go for the Bulls. But I'm not gonna lie, this is all I had, so I go for the Bulls today. But tomorrow, we are dressing up as Bogans, truly Aussie. So go raid Isaac Penman's closet, you'll be good.
Yeah, come in your Australian attire. Is that
Australian attire?
Yeah.
Does anyone have like one of those hats with the corks in it? I don't, but I really want someone tomorrow to show up with it. I'll like, I don't know, give you a shout out if you do. Hey, last thing, really quickly. I'm going to mention it every day, so just beware. Our Friday competition. I've already got a submission, guys. It's so funny. I can't stop giggling every single time I watch it. So our theme is, like one of these videos, just stereotype Avondale. No longer than 30 seconds. I'll put it in a little compilation.
And make
Send
sure it's appropriate.
Send it to my
Sorry.
Instagram. And it's great. I've heard some of your ideas and they actually sound so good. So bring them to life and they'll be great. Yeah, guys. Hey, have a great day. Have a great FOF session. We're hearing from Rahel this morning. Isn't that exciting?
Yeah, and also make sure you come to the night program because Pastor Alina is going to be talking.
Yeah. Woo!
So exciting.
Hey, okay. It's time to get back into some praise and worship. So let's invite them back up and praise.
Enjoy.
Why don't you stand up with us as we praise?
I search the world, but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise and treasures that fade are never enough. Then you came along and pulled me back together. Every desire is now satisfied here in your love. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing. Nothing is better than you. Oh, I'm not afraid to show you my weakness, my failures and flaws. Lord, you've seen them all and you still call me friend. 'Cause the God of the mountain is the God of the valley. There's not a place your mercy and grace won't find me again. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing. Nothing is better than you. Dancing. You give beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn grace into God. Touch seas into highways. You're the only one who can. You turn water into dancing. You give beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You're the only. than you, oh, there's nothing better than you, Lord, there's nothing. Nothing is better than you.
I want you guys to stay with us in this moment as we head into our next song. And this next song we're going to sing is a bit of a new one. And it says, such an awesome God, so mighty, so wonderful, so powerful, so faithful he is. So as we sing these songs, I just want you to reflect on the words and just really understand just how awesome our God is.
Let's pray. Jesus, you are awesome. And to say you are awesome is to say that you are awe-inspiring, that you evoke something out of us that just doesn't make sense. We can't understand you, and we probably won't ever understand the full you, but we are in awe. We stand here in awe. We love you so much. Please be with us. Please help us to pay attention today. Please help us to learn something about you today. This we pray in Jesus' name, and everybody said, amen.
Amen. My goods, whoa. All right. Good morning. I want to tell you a story today, and it's the story of the man who sat. Now, as the story suggests, there once was a man who sat, and he was known for sitting around. As people walked past him and as they looked at him, they'd go, you know, hey, you know, there goes that man sitting in that same place again. And you know, as he sat, he watched. He watched and observed as people walked around him, as they lived their lives. And I'm sure a part of him wondered, you know, what kind of story do these people have in their lives? But you see, as he sat and as he watched and he observed, there was a sadness to him. You see, because he didn't sit because he chose to sit. He sat because he was paralyzed. And for 38 years, he sat watching and observing. 38 years stuck in one spot. I want you to feel something here. Feel something as he longs to walk again. Feel something as he wishes he could live the life that everyone who walks in front of him could live. Feel his pain. Feel his longing. 38 years crippled. I want to share you another story about how I was crippled for 2 hours. So I liked this girl. And just a word of warning, no good story of mine ever starts with that. But I liked this girl. And I remember our year level went on this camping trip. It was the first camping trip of the year, and we set up our tents in a clearing among the forest. And after we finished setting up our tents, we decided just to have some free time, and a group of us decided to play a game called Markers Up. Now, the game is simple. Most of you would know it, but you kick a ball. One person kicks a ball, a whole group of us try to catch it. Perfect. But as I looked to my side, there she was. In her group, but facing what was going on here. And so a part of my schooling life, a focus of mine, was to get this girl to like me back, obviously. To get this girl to like me back. So I want you guys to think about this. What do you do when you have feelings for someone? When you like them? You talk to them, build relationships with them, make them laugh, spend some quality time? Not me. I'm built different. In my mind, if I wanted this girl to like me back, I had to impress her. And so here I was in this game, and when I saw her in that group, I realized that in order to impress her today, I had to perform an athletic feat like the world had never seen before. And I was ready. I was ready. So here we had the game, and one of my friends who was kicking, he kicked the ball, and it was a high kick, but it went off to the side, her side. And instantly I knew what I had to do. I was looking at the ball, and I calculated in my head. I looked at the height of the ball. I calculated the velocity that in which it was traveling at. All these mathematical equations were in my head, and I knew the exact time I needed to start running, the exact speed in which I needed to run in order for me to perform this classic catch. So it was on. I started running. Perfect. Speed. Perfect. Distance, perfect. My calculations, perfect. And as I ran, and I saw the ball falling down, and I jumped. Perfect. I was in the air, horizontal to the ground. I was flying. And as I was in the air, I saw the ball fall down. And I imagined my future. She would see me, fall in love, marry me, kids, we'd grow old together. You see, my future was relying on this very one moment. And so when I jumped, I knew life was going to be good. So, in the process of my calculations, I unfortunately failed to notice the large, thick wooden signpost in the way. Yeah. So as I said, I was running at maximum velocity, eh? And I hit that thing. I hit that thing so hard. And I fell down quite spectacularly, face forward. Yeah, face planted, basically. As I said, like, she was in full view of this. She saw it, so there went my future. And it was sad because as I got up and my leg was hurting and I was rubbing it, I was like, man, you know, like, this hurts. But it didn't hurt as much as the emotional pain I was feeling. And as I sat there for 2 hours unable to move, I felt that man's pain. I really didn't. But those 2 hours were honestly probably one of the worst 2 hours of my life. But yeah, last night, Ray explored the idea, what does it mean to sit at the table? And he shared this quote. He said, to sit is to trust. To sit is to trust. It's a response from us. As we sit, we put ourselves into the hands of our Creator. But I want to take a step back from this and answer the question, what exactly do we get from the table? Why should we sit at the table? What is there for us? And here we come back to the man who sat. We hear the story of this man in John chapter 5. And it says here, I'm going to follow along the screen because I've got a different version here. And it says, afterwards, Jesus returned to Jerusalem for one of the Jewish holy days. Inside the city, near the sheep gate, was the pool of Bethesda with 5 covered porches. Crowds of sick people, blind, lame, or paralyzed, lay on these porches. One of the men lying there had been sick for 38 years. When Jesus saw him, and he knew he had been ill for a long time, he asked him, would you like to get well? So here we introduce to the man who sat. And there are things working here that we need to understand. There are things in the background that make his condition so much more worse. And I want to start off by saying that first of all, in Jesus' time in Jewish society, a man's worth was based and solidified on whether he could provide for his family. So could he work? Could he craft something? Could he run a business? Because if he could, and if he did all that, and it was profitable, and he provided for his family, he was a valued man. But if he couldn't work, if he was paralyzed, he was worthless. He didn't have a place. 38 years, a man with no value. The second thing going on here, and this is huge. It was believed back then that if you suffered from a disability, either you or your parents did something so bad that you were being punished right now. Do you get what I'm trying to say here? So not only was this man worthless for society, but he was at fault for his condition. So whenever people walked by him, they didn't see someone who needed compassion. They didn't see someone who needed empathy. They saw someone who got exactly what he had coming to him. This man lived with no compassion. Not from his friends, not from his family, not from his people. He lived his whole life believing he had no seat at the table because that's what the world told him. You can sit outside, but not inside. You can sit around, but not with us. You have no seat at the table. This man had no compassion, But I want to approach something here, in that compassion wasn't waiting for him. It was moving towards him in the form of someone we know as Jesus Christ. We pick up the story at John chapter 5, verse 6. If we can get up on the screen. And it says, when Jesus saw him and knew he had been ill for a long time, he asked him, "Would you like to get well?" "I can't, sir," the sick man said, "for I have no one to put me into the pool when the water bubbles up. Someone else always gets there ahead of me." So he had a hope. He had something in front of him that he was trying to reach, but it was too far. And it says, Jesus told him, "Stand up, pick up your mat, and walk." Instantly the man was healed. He rolled up his sleeping mat and began walking. But this miracle happened on the Sabbath. 38 years of being paralyzed, and here he is. The day where he's finally free. The day where he can walk again. But there's a bit of a kick in this story. Because when we're reading this, we see like we see the pain. 38 years. But if you're a Jewish person, something strikes you at the end. And that is this: the day on which this took place was a Sabbath. The Sabbath day. You see, time is very important to God. I almost always imagined God's love language would be quality time. Time is so sacred to Him. So much so that even though we live beyond the ideal set at creation, He still sets forth time for us. We've been exploring the idea of the Jubilee at church and even the Sabbath. This idea of sacred time. And this was the Sabbath. Psalm 23, chapter 23, verse 2 says, "He makes me lie down in green pastures and He leads me beside quiet waters." This is our answer to what we get from the table. He lets me rest in green meadows and He leads me beside peaceful streams. What do we get from the table but rest? What do we get from the table but freedom? But you see, even though I'm saying all these things, something different is felt. Because even though we live as, some of us live as Adventists, who live in the reality of Sabbath, there's tension. Because we are told we can rest, but sometimes things can feel a bit restrictive. We're told we can come to this day and be ourselves, but we've got to dress and look a certain way at church. There's tension here. Because rest does not have restriction. Rest is liberation. You see, in those times, there was something called the Talmud. The Talmud. And this was a work of literature that was written by the Pharisees, written by the religious leaders in the time of Jesus. And in this, there was 39 categories of things that you couldn't do on the Sabbath. So I'm not talking about 39 specific things. I'm talking about 39 subheadings, each with detailed things that you couldn't do on the Sabbath. And one of these things was carrying your mat. You were not allowed to carry your mat on the Sabbath. So then why does Jesus tell this man to pick up his mat? Why can't he just heal him and let him go to the rest of his day? You see, when Jesus tells this man to carry his mat, he rebels against the restrictive laws of man, not of God, but of man, and reclaims the Sabbath day for God. He reclaims the Sabbath to bring freedom for his people. Liberation. That's a theme I'm trying to get here. Liberation, freedom. The table is not there for you to be stuck. The table is not there for you to be still. The table is there so you can come and be yourself and be free. You see, for 38 years, this man sat looking for salvation that was in front of him. For 38 years, this man tried to enter the pool of Bethesda for his healing, believing in a miracle that so many others had gotten before him, but he could not reach. He wasn't good enough. He wasn't quick enough. And each time, he was reminded of how worthless, useless he was. For 38 years, he tried to work for his own freedom. He tried to work for his own salvation. But here's the kicker. Salvation wasn't in front of him. Salvation was moving towards him. Salvation was on its way. Freedom was on its way in the character of God. You see, he thought he had to do all the work when he saw the pool in front of him. But Christ did the work when he moved towards him. Christ did the work. A man with no place, no place in Israel, no place in family, no place at the table. You see, I've been reflecting this week about something and I find myself in a situation where I feel stuck, stationary, almost reactive to the circumstances around me. And I've always wondered, how is a theology student who's planning to graduate feel this way? How can I be stuck? How can the table be so far to me? But you see, the table is not about what we can take from it, but who invites us to sit. It's not about what's on there and what we can grab and what we can eat, but who the host is, who the character of God is. That's the beauty of the table. Because even when the table is too far away from you, even if you feel like in your situation where you can't move towards the table moves to you. The table goes closer to you because the table wants to be in relationship with you. You could be 38 years. You could be 16 years. No matter your circumstance, no matter where you're at, the table moves to you. So what exactly do we get from the table? We get a reason. We get purpose, impetus, movement, a reason to trust, a reason to believe, a reason to have faith, a reason to focus ourselves, not on the salvation we're working for, but to focus on ourselves on the person who moves towards us. So to those of us who can't move, to those of us who feel like we want to be free but can't do anything about it, take heart, because Jesus moves. Christ walks. The table is not stationary. Christ wants you to be seated with him, and he is on his way. So here's my question. Where do you need God to take you? Because when you sit, you know you are in the hands of the Good Shepherd who cares for you and moves towards you. It's not about what's on the table, but who invites us to sit. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I appreciate who you are, Lord, every single day. I want to thank you so much, Lord, for your character, your movement. And I want to thank you so much, Lord, for being the table that moves towards us, Lord. At the end of the day, it's not about what's on it, but who invites us to sit, Lord. And thank you so much for calling each and every one of us to this table. I pray as we journey along this week, as we learn more about our seat, our place, and about you, Lord, May we remember to always, always consecrate us in front of you. May we surrender whatever we have to the foot of your cross. And may we live this amazing, beautiful, glorious purpose you have for us as we sit with you. This I pray in your name. Amen.
Do we sing this next song?
Sometimes hard to show up to the morning session, but we actually really do appreciate you coming to the morning ones.
Just want to say thank you to Rahel. Oh, my voice, sorry. Where's Rahel? Hey, that was so good. Can we give a round of applause for Rahel? Before we get into the announcements, we're just going to give a little plug to Salt Avondale, the Instagram. Is it going to come up?
No.
Oh, it's not going to come up on the screen, but you can find it on Instagram. Just type in Salt.
Yeah,
Instagram.
If you guys have a story you want to post or anything really, they're going to repost you. So if you want a quick little shout out, why not? Get on it.
All your four photos, tag them and they'll repost it.
Yeah, absolutely. Just want to reaffirm the idea that if at any moment in this session you were like, I really want, like, something's just come up in my brain and I really want to talk about this. There are people here to support you. There are people here to talk to you, listen to you, whatever you need. This is what we're about. We are about at FOF, and we just want you guys to remember this every single day.
Mm-hmm. And does anyone know what time tonight's program starts at? Yeah, 7. So come at 7, guys, for the night program.
Yeah. Hey, yeah. And quick reminder. You remember that really cute short girl with the black short hair that preached at FOF last semester? Yeah, she's doing it again tonight. So please don't miss it. It's going to be so, so good. We're done for now. We have lunch over in camp. Go get there. Have a seat at the table. Meet someone new. It's going to be great. Okay. Have a great day, guys.
Have a great Tuesday.
I shall come for you.